Bone Thugs and Harmony and 3-6 Mafia. They definitely are two of the greatest rap groups of all time. Both have extensive catalogs and have etched their legacy into music history. However, way before both these groups saw the height of their success, they would have a feud. Before I get more into the video, I would first like to thank you guys for coming to see this, because you guys can be doing a million other things right now, but instead, you're here with me, and I appreciate that. If you guys like the content, you guys should like, comment, and subscribe to help the channel grow. Also, follow my Instagram too, that would be greatly appreciated. Comment down below your favorite tracks from 3-6 Mafia and Bone Thugs and Harmony, favorite albums by them as well, and why. Also, let me know where you are tuning in from, represent where you're from. Without further ado, I give you Bone Thugs and Harmony vs. 3-6 Mafia, the story behind the beef. Before I get into what sparked the quote-unquote beef, I have to get into the backstory of both groups, kind of like how I do with everyone on this series of videos. Bone Thugs and Harmony formed in Cleveland, Ohio. The group was originally comprised of Lazy Bone, Wishbone, Crazy Bone, and Busy Bone. Flesh and Bone will come in later, and he is the brother of Lazy Bone, and they're both cousins of Wishbone. They grew up on the rough side of Cleveland with a lot of crime, drugs, you know, all that, you know, other stuff that comes with that, but it was all around each member growing up. And while people in the group were out and about back in their adolescent years, they would sit on the block and stand around and sing old songs like how people used to do way back in the day. I'm pretty sure people like have seen it in like movies from like way back then when people did things like that. Perfect example would be in the Temptations movie when the people did it on there, or in other movies you have the scenes of it being like cold outside and people are like huddled up around like a fire or like a barrel singing. That's what members of Bone used to do, and that turned into the thought of harmonizing at certain parts in the song when they would do it. The singing would then turn into a contest of who could fit the most words into a bar or verse, which led to their raps speeding up over time. Members of Bone would first form a group by the name of the Band-Aid Boys before changing their name to Bone Enterprise. Now, if you want to know what Bone stands for, here's a clip of the members explaining it.
You know what I'm saying? And if you was to break it down as fast as my troop just said it to you, you know what I'm saying? It would stand for Bone. Brewed out niggas every day. Hooded out niggas every day. And brothers on normal elimination. And if you take the thug, you know what I'm saying? Take the thug.
Truth housing underground shit.
And sound if you don't want a nigga to cuss.
The group would release their first, I guess, album or project, if you want to call it that, in 1993. The project was released on an independent label via a record store owner in Cleveland who helped the group record the project. The thing is that this tape didn't really have a huge impact because the rap scene in Cleveland at the time was so limited, even the Midwest period, because there really isn't any like huge like record companies like an Interscope, Atlantic, RCA, etc., for example. So the group had to think bigger than Cleveland. Because of this, the group would come up with a plan to catch a Greyhound bus on a one-way ticket all the way to Los Angeles, California, in hopes to meet up with Eazy-E. Now, as to why specifically Eazy-E, well, this is what Lazy Bone had to say. Eazy-E was known, but he was also a CEO. He was the Berry Gordy of our time. We always loved NWA, and Eazy being the boss at the time, he was the underdog. Dog Pound was tearing their A up, and we felt like we were better than them. We needed some competition. We wanted to be in position to be the best because Dr. Dre was killing it. People know Eazy-E for his solo work and work with NWA, but he also had Ruthless Records. I mean, outside of him and NWA, I mean, Ruthless had some success. JJ Fad's debut album, Supersonic, went gold. The DOC's debut album, No One Can Do It Better, went platinum. And Mr. Lay's self-titled debut album went gold. Like I said, that's not including NWA, members of NWA, or Eazy-E himself. But the group would just be out in LA for months, just being homeless, bouncing around until they got a big break. The group would constantly call Ruthless Records until one day Eazy-E would pick up and request to speak to Bone. Because after that first project I was talking about, the group was just strictly going by the name Bone. Here's what Crazy Bone had to say about the situation. He actually called us. We was out in Los Angeles and got his number from someone that we was working with back home in Cleveland. He gave us the number and we kept calling the Ruthless Records record label every day. Keisha Anderson was the secretary at the time and we would call, she would always answer. One day she was like, I am going to make sure he call y'all back because you've been calling every day. He called us back that day and Busy answered the phone, tossed it to me and said, rap. I got to Bustin and E was on the other side. I could hear him in the background and he was like, dang, where did y'all say y'all from again? We said Cleveland. He said to hold on and he put me on hold. Then he put me on speakerphone with other people in the office. And he was like, say that rap again. I said it again and gauged people's reaction in the background. And they were all like, what the hell? From there, he let us know he had a show in Cleveland and we hustled up money to get back to Cleveland to try to open up the show. The person who gave us the number to Ruthless Records told us if we made it back to Cleveland, we could open up. Here's, I think, one of the raps that was said over the phone. I think I heard like some other members rapped over the phone, but Crazy Bone did rap his verse from the song Flow Motion, which was a song on the group's 1993 project, Faces of Death. Here's part of the verse if you've never heard it.
What Crazy Bone is bucking the ones again. The suckers they pick up, they pin
and they try to get 10% single that they win. It's dead Mac 10, it's blasting. Pick up my gun and
you're running up from the assassin. I'm popping the clip and they asking. Who a nigga was that mass man? The nigga that's pulling the trigger in just cause I'm slimmer. They figure they bigger, but when you consider the skill that they're spilling your cap. Done with them thugs, just rolling the pack. The straps so pack your gad. If I see you like I'ma see with the mind.
The group would scrounge up money to go back to Cleveland and open up for Eazy. After the show, after they performed, the group walked to the backstage area and they were stopped at the dressing room, but they stood outside of it. They asked if they could rap for DJ Yella. Eazy-E heard them and stuck his head outside of the dressing room and asked if they were the dudes from Cleveland that had been calling him. He then brought them back and from there is pretty much history. Also, Bone had a song called Thugs in Harmony and Eazy suggested they combine that with Bone, so now they would be Bone Thugs in Harmony. But Eazy would get the group into some studio sessions and get them tapped in with DJ Unique, and in April of 1994, the song Thuggish Ruggish Bone would release and ended up peaking at number 20 on the Billboard Hot 100. The interesting thing about that song is that people were in Eazy-E's ear saying that they should put out For the Love of Money out first and having doubts about Thuggish Ruggish Bone. Eazy kinda didn't hear it at first, but all of a sudden he agreed and it was released as the first single, and the group's debut EP was released in June of 1994, peaking at number 12 on the Billboard 200. That's a very brief backstory on the history of Bone. A couple months ago, I did a whole video on 36 Mafia, which you should definitely check out because it definitely seems to be a fan favorite and a lot of people reached out to me saying that they loved the video. But anyways, we can trace the origins of 36 back to when DJ Paul and Lord Infamous were young kids, both being musically talented. Fun fact, DJ Paul and Lord Infamous are not brothers, and instead, Lord Infamous is DJ Paul's nephew. DJ Paul's sister is Lord Infamous's mom, but DJ Paul had talent in such things like playing the organ while Lord Infamous used to sing. They started making music together where Paul would produce and do the occasional hook while Lord Infamous rapped. DJ Paul had this to say in an interview with Complex. We came out the door with an EP, artwork, cover pressed up, shrink wrapped, and everything. That was in 1990. The group was initially called the Serial Killers, and the name of the tape was Portrait of a Serial Killer. After that, I went to the regular mixtapes on TDK tapes. At this time, on the other side of Memphis, Juicy J will be doing his thing, and in the interview with Vulture, he had this to say. I was DJing clubs and any little birthday parties. I started when I was 16. I didn't have the money to get the equipment, but I could scratch pretty good. F that pretty good. I was the stuff. I would listen to DJ Jazzy Jeff, and I would try to duplicate his scratches and see if I could do the same things he did. I was a cold scratcher. You know the Transformer sound? I was fast and quick with it. I had some crazy techniques I was doing in my younger years. I met this guy named D Magic. He was a DJ in town, kind of an old school cat. I immediately jumped on his turntables, scratching and stuff. He was like, dang, you cold, man. We should start a business. So he would set the equipment up and I would come in and do the music. We split the money down the middle. Everybody knew me around the town as Juicy J or Notorious Juicy J. I would spray paint my name all over the streets, on walls, wherever I could. Juicy J would have his homeboys that he knew to come in and rap. But in Juicy's words, everybody he grew up with around that time was a criminal or constantly in and out of jail. He would invite them out, but a lot of the times they wouldn't show up because they were constantly getting locked up. Juicy finally had enough, so he grabbed the mic and started to rap himself. When asked how he eventually met DJ Paul, Juicy J said this: he was the hottest DJ on the south side of town, and I was the hottest DJ on the north side of town. This guy that I knew when I was at OTS Records, which was 8-Ball and MJG's record label at the time, introduced me to Paul. Paul had a lot of equipment, a lot of keyboards, and a nice, good, expensive 4-track. We just hit it off. We started making stuff together, and people started going crazy about our mixtapes. We started making a lot of noise, and Paul was always rapping too. He and his brother Lord Infamous with their group, the Serial Killers. To make a long story short, we started 3-6 Mafia, me, Paul, and Lord Infamous. Before there were 3-6 Mafia though, both Paul and Lord Infamous would join Juicy J's crew of the Backyard Posse. That crew didn't work out, so DJ Paul said that he regained control, and then that turned into 666 Mafia, which in turn turned into 3-6 Mafia. In the early days, 3-6 Mafia would also expand from just initially having three members to adding members like Koopsta, Gangsta Boo, and Crunchy Black. Playa Fly, Gangsta Black, Kingpin Skinny Pimp, and some other people I think were involved in the group as well at a certain time, but the story of all those people involved in the group and the result of what happened is an entire mess, and like I said in the 3-6 Mafia video, it's a story for a whole other day. It's just, yeah. But in 1994, 3-6 Mafia would drop their first mixtape as a group, which was called Smoked Out, Loked Out. The next year, in May of 1995, 3-6 Mafia will release their debut album, Mystic Styles. Alright, I just wanted to give a brief backstory behind both 3-6 Mafia and Bone Thugs to set the scene. Now, this second part will be me explaining the beef between the groups, but before I continue, I have to say that when I say the term beef, at least in this video, I don't mean in the sense of like Young Jeezy and Gucci Man, like, you know, in that type of way, where it's like on site. People have died, you know what I mean, like all that bad stuff. On my last beef video I did on Paul Wall and Chamillionaire, I was getting comments about, oh, this isn't a real beef, blah, 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 blah. But in like that case, like that specific case I was talking about, there was definitely some tension and people got hurt and even arrested, facing jail time during that beef. So that's like a different case. But this beef between Bone Thugs and 3-6 was almost entirely on wax. You'll hear later why I say almost entirely. But, and plus, they're all good now, you know what I mean? So everything is good. I'm just breaking down the history. Anyways, let's get into the second part of the video. Now, how this beef started is actually kind of confusing. This is Crazy's take on what happened. The whole beef with 3-6, that was something I really never even understood. What was the beef about? From what I hear, it all started when we was reading fan mail back in the day. We went to the office at Ruthless Records and opened up the fan mail. I had read it, and some chick from Memphis was telling me there's this group out here. They made an album that's on the radio, and they dissing y'all, saying that y'all stole their style. They called themselves 3-6 Mafia. So we heard about it, and one time we had a show in Memphis and we was getting ready to walk into the show and we heard somebody scream out, Thuggish Ruggish Busters. We turned around and we was like, what? We ready to run down there. Our security was telling us, y'all getting ready to go on stage and do a show and get paid. They in the parking lot. Let's keep going and get this money. I really didn't understand what the beef was until I talked to somebody on the phone one day. it was a conference call with Relativity Records or Live Records or something. And they was like, we just want y'all to know, it ain't no beef, it ain't no nothing. All that stuff was stupid. We was young. Everybody was young. So when the opportunity came to work with Gangsta Boo, I was like, man, let's make it happen. Let's squash some of this beef that's out there. Let's do this. It's about business for real. So that's Crazy's version of what happened. Now, according to DJ Paul of 36 Mafia, he said the conflict started over a misunderstanding. It wasn't a real beef. It was more of a misunderstanding because we was rapping about 666, devil stuff, and tongue twisting over slow beats. We had been doing that since 1989. And then all of a sudden, when Bone came out, I think it was 1993, we didn't know the Faces of Death album because it was their underground stuff. Just like they probably didn't know our underground stuff. When they came out with Thuggish Ruggish Bone and all of that, and we hear somebody kind of on our same style, Faces of Death, Red Rum, Murder, 666, Tongue Twisting, we were like, dang, these dudes done stole our style. That's why we got mad about it. We ran into each other a couple of times and there was a push or something, but there was never no fight or nothing like that. Now people think that they were just beefing because of the flow, but this confirms that it was more than that, which some people already knew. It was the whole aesthetic of the dark stuff Paul mentioned with the flows. I mean, like, this beef is attached to like so many other beefs, like it's insane. I mean, like, people from Memphis, like Tommy Wright III was going at Bone. Crucial Conflict from Chicago was going at Bone. Twista from Chicago going at Bone, etc. But here's a clip of Bone and Lord Infamous of 36 Mafia's flow back to back. I'll let you, the audience, decide the similarities or differences.
So, no different than you chill with the when I get mustard and I'm killing it when I get feeling the pain. When I go insane and I take the 30 years to your brain. There's never another nigga with a brother, a smother, a sucker, and go undercover and leaving me good as you claim me get tough. But who was the sucker that's calling the murder of 187? The weapon is kept in your step and you're learning your lesson.
Essence of the blessings keep me puzzled like enigma. My potter put me down with a stop bound of compressed chiba. My smoking flows like blissful music notes from mysterious Jifa. On Halloween, I pass it out to all the trick-or-treaters. In 1999, the Middle East will come nuclear bombers. So now, Lord Infamous blessing out with 60 bull and Pocahontas. Smoke out your lungs and powder your nose. We grabbing big bushes or something. We kicking, we breaking our season. We breaking our sticks and we breaking our cigars and making our stick. 666 Mafia getting surrounded because we get out of this atmosphere with all the smoke in her eyes. The bloody reverberation and tears. Clouds on the right, on the left, to the rear. Scare from me keep clouds of smoke flying out to me lungs. Me keep the spices sprinkled down like a Cajun.
But about that show that Bone had in Memphis. Well, in February of 1995, Bone appeared in Vibe magazine. And in an article, Lazy referred to Memphis as a bunk town. Later on in the profile article, word would get back to Bone that a Memphis crew, which ended up being 36 Mafia, was talking mess about them, and Wishbone would say this: "We stole your career and y'all let it ride for 6 months. We ain't never been to this state. And I know they can't come to East 1999 talking no stuff like that." The article would end with the concert that Bone did in Memphis, like Crazy mentioned earlier, and about 3 songs into their set, multiple men jumped on stage, and yeah, y'all know the rest. Complete sidebar. I'm recording this after I recorded the original audio for this video, but I just realized something that has me confused. So Crazy Bone said that the problem with 36 Mafia arose after the fan mail thing with that person in Memphis saying that 36 Mafia was dissing them and had an album on the radio. If this Vibe article came out in February of 1995, then that means the concert had to have been the same month or before, which would mean Bone Thugs were aware of 36 Mafia before Mystic Styles even came out. Mystic Styles didn't even come out until May of 1995, and Live By Your Rep, the Bonedest EP, didn't come out until November of that same year. I don't think this person was talking about Smoked Out, Loped Out in 1994. In the Vibe article, it says that the group learned that a Memphis crew, which we know today as 36 Mafia, had some hostile words for them, basically saying that they jacked their style. Now, I don't know if they found out via fan mail or words of mouth, but I'm just confused as to what the person writing the fan mail was referring to music-wise from 3-6 Mafia. Maybe after the Memphis concert, Bone Thugs didn't know 3-6 Mafia's name and they found out via this fan mail, which came after, after Mystic Styles dropped. I mean, I assume so, but yeah, I'm just super confused. Like, someone tell me if I'm bugging in the comments, but back to the original story. Also, according to DJ Paul, sometime after the Memphis show, 3-6 Mafia and Bone ran into each other at the Atlanta airport, but nothing really happened. But to take things back a little bit, 3-6 Mafia will release their debut album, Mystic Styles, in May of 1995. This album contains one of the most underrated diss tracks of all time, and it's Live By A Rep. This song is crazy. Please listen to it if you haven't yet. The beat is really sinister, the lyrics are just savage and haunting, and the hook is just really good and memorable. Everybody went off on this track, but I give the MVP to Lord Infamous. All of the verses on his song are dope, and on his last verse, he name flips the members of Bone, and it's just like so dope. In July of that year, Bone Thugs will release their album, East 1999 Eternal, and unfortunately, this would be released months after the death of Eazy-E. R.I.P. Eazy-E. On this album, there really isn't any super direct disses at 3-6 Mafia. That wouldn't come until later. In November of that year, 3-6 Mafia will release the Live By A Rep Bone Diss EP, which contained two different versions of the song Live By A Rep. There was a radio and a screwed version to Live By A Rep, but Bone wouldn't release an album in 1996, and 3-6 didn't release an album until the tail end of that year. 1996 would be the year other people like Memphis artist Tiny Wright III would go at Bone, and Tiny Wright III, Thuggish Ruckus Busters, his diss track on Bone is crazy too. Like, bro, definitely check that out. But it wasn't until 1997 when Bone Thugs collabed with Biggie and did the song Notorious Thugs, which appeared on Biggie's album Life After Death, which released in March of that year, to where people perceived Bone took a shot at 3-6. Weeks before the album released, Biggie would pass away, so RIP Biggie Smalls. But on the song Notorious Thugs, Busy Bone would say the lines, "We mean mug mo thugs, trained to be perfect disciples. When it's survival, tongue is a double-edged sword. 666 rival spitting fire." This is interesting because some people perceive this as a diss and some don't. People break down the line of 666 spitting fire differently. Some people just pick out the word rival and view it as a diss, while others say that Busy was saying 3-6 were their rivals, but they were spitting fire. Let me know in the comment section what you think. Some members of 3-6 Mafia took this as a diss. Both Crunchy Black and DJ Paul have talked about this in interviews. Crunchy Black said that he heard in the industry that the reason why Bone Thugs didn't completely say 3-6 Mafia's name is because they didn't want to push 3-6 over the top and give them more shine. It wouldn't be a surprise to me if this was actually true, because a lot of rappers like do this even today, where they don't want to say a smaller artist's name to give them clout. But like I said, this is what Crunchy Black said, so don't come at me. But Crunchy would also add to the fact that 3-6 thought that Bone took their style, because according to Crunchy, DJ Paul and Lord Infamous had the afros, Dickie shorts and pants, Oshkosh, Bagosh, etc. But a couple months after Notorious Thugs dropped, Bone Thugs dropped their album, The Art of War, in July of 1997. On this album, Bone was going at a lot of people they were beefing with at the time. Bone had problems with a lot of people, man. Like, I don't think that people really realize that. I forgot to mention earlier that Do or Die of Chicago was one of the groups that they had problems with, and yeah. But on this album, they were sending mad shots at their rivals. I heard that Do or Die has a crazy diss track towards Bone 2, and I heard it, and geez, like, people were not lying. Like, they went crazy. But even on Busy Bone's debut album, Heaven's Movie, which released in October of 1998, people think that he was sending shots at Gangsta Boo on the song The Roof Is On Fire by saying this: act a little bit feminine, take the fatigues off, F the club, even the six, it's hellish, I be the one to tell it, lust for the thugs, even the 636, it's hellish. Gangsta Boo is the only female member of 36 Mafia, the group. I will say though, that by the time of 1998-1999, the beef between Bone and 36 kind of slowed down. Project Pat, who was the brother of Juicy J, and even though Pat wasn't officially 36 Mafia, he was heavily affiliated, but him and Crazy Bone recorded a song called Up There in 1998, but the song would be released in September of 1999 on Project Pat's debut album, Get It Green. Early in 1999 though, on Crazy Bone's debut album, Thug Mentality 1999, which released in April of that year, he had Gangsta Boo feature on a song called We Starving. So everything seemed to be well, but you see, the thing is that Bone Thugs and Harmony was in a weird place because of the problems in the group. And Crazy Bone said in the interview that he hadn't talked to the rest of the group about what was going on with him and what he was doing with the people I just mentioned, so other members of the group were still on go mode. But I will say that DJ Paul, LeChat, and Juicy J did appear in the video for the Lil Jon and the Eastside Boys song, I Don't Give a F, which Crazy Bone is featured on. That was in 2002, I believe. Everything nowadays is cool between the two crews. They've done shows together, and from what I managed to research, I think that DJ Paul and Crazy Bone are working together on a project. Everything is gravy now, and that leads up to the day I'm dropping this video. 36 Mafia and Bone Thugs and Harmony are set to do a versus battle. Here's the thing though, Bone Thugs and Harmony and 36 Mafia were initially supposed to do an event independently from Versus in April of 2020, but the co-founders of Versus, which are Swizz Beatz and Timbaland, intervened and the battle was canceled. According to DJ Paul, Swizz Beatz had contacted Crazy Bone less than an hour before their Instagram Live battle was scheduled to begin and persuaded him to postpone the event. That leads up to today, and the battle is officially set to go down.